The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Jesus said to the crowds, "This is how it is with the kingdom of God. It is as if a man were to scatter seed on the land, and would sleep and rise night and day, and through it all the seeds would sprout and grow, he knows not how. Of his own accord, the land yields fruit. First the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. And when the grain is ripe, he wields the sickle at once, for the harvest has come." He said, "To what shall we compare the kingdom of God? Or what parable can we use for it? It is like a mustard seed that, when it is sown in the ground, it is the smallest of all the seeds on the earth. But once it is grown, it springs up and becomes the largest of plants, and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the sky may dwell in its shade." With many parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to understand it. Without parables, he did not speak to them, but to his own disciples, he explained everything in private. The Gospel of the Lord. So as finally some come to their senses and realize that, you know, for all its propaganda, that this was really nothing more than a seasonal flu. Because you never heard, like, how many people died of the regular flu this year? Or, I don't know, any other disease for that matter. Like, every death was, you know, said to be COVID. Now, I got directly, like, through the car window. Right, like, this close. And we shook hands, and none of us were feeling anything. And then the next day, he came down with, far worse symptoms than me. I just got tired for like 2 weeks. So I went and got tested, negative. So I self-quarantined for 2 weeks, negative. Now, I'm gonna go see my primary doctor this week because that was the earliest I can get in, but I want him to check my serum. You know, don't let the lie be perpetuated, because what it does, it's a fear monger. It makes people live in fear. And that's not what God tells us to do. He's like, be not afraid. We can take care of ourselves. We could, you know, like, it doesn't mean that you just reject all kinds of things that are vaccines, like measles, mumps, polio, smallpox. These kinds of things are there, but they were far worse. Far worse. And so it is when the devil gets into our head and starts working his stuff, because he's the master of lies. The master of lies. And he'll get you even hating yourself. It's a very hard thing to get out from under that without being, you know, in meaningful relationships with other people. It is hard to sit in your own house alone, because man is not meant to be alone. And certainly in a marriage relationship, but in every relationship, man is not meant to be alone. And without those relationships, both with God and each other, we're not very fruitful. Because we're designed to be in relationship. Love is a relationship, it's not a thing. And if you nurture it, it will grow. If you don't, it will wither. So come the examples that God is using about the mustard seed and the farmer, and, you know, that he's going to plant this really great cedar in Jerusalem, and that everything branches from it. So God becomes that image of shelter, of a place that we can go to when we feel like we're in danger, or we want to sleep peacefully and not worry all night long, to be a place that we can find good food, you know, good things that are there. You know, I got to get somebody to help me with my bird feeders because there's so many birds coming these days. But there's a goodness in us being in a relationship. I didn't know how bad I missed it until I went, you know, out to a really nice lunch and wasn't rushed. And people weren't wearing masks, so you could actually see what their facial expressions were. And, you know, pull it down between every forkful. I don't know, I didn't go out to eat and do that kind of stuff because I just wasn't buying into it all. The thing is that, you know, God tells us too that, you know, we see him in the breaking of the bread. Truly, in the Mass, we see that. You know, that God is always with us. He will not leave us orphans, and he hasn't yet. And at the same time, you know, we need to eat together. You know, not watching the boob tube, you know, while eating dinner, turn it off. You know, the phrase that one person said to me one time, I've always kept in there, if TV is not your God, then why is all your furniture pointed to it? Now, it you know, there's some good programming on there, but there's a lot of not good. So where do we get fed? We get fed by being in relationship with people who think as we do. Because, you know, few of us are called to try and change the mind of somebody whose mind is stuck in a rut. And they, you know, they just believe whatever somebody tells them, and then they stick to that, and then they're not a free thinker. But Scripture is all about thinking freely. It's not a cult or a trap. It's a way that God delivers to us the understanding that he has freed us. He has freed us not to just be independent operators, but to take that freedom and join it with other people's freedom. Now, not everybody's going to agree with that. I mean, that's clear. And not all will come to the kingdom of God. You know, if you choose not to believe, if you choose not to see this, you know, you just get, well, I'm kind of good. No. But being in relationship, especially with people who are of a like mind, who, especially those closest to you that are willing to say, you know, that might not be fruitful, what you're doing, what you're saying, what you're thinking, what you're believing. So we all need to go back into the security of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You know, so we understand that our salvation comes to Jesus Christ. We're truly free. We're not conjoined to the ruler of this world, Satan. And the Holy Spirit will empower us to understand more deeply the teachings of Almighty God in the Scripture and in the tradition of the Church. And that's an important thing, is that we understand that it's not just Scripture. It's not just sola scriptura, Scripture only. It's about how we could talk about the mysteries of God so that everyone, regardless of who they are, what language they speak, what cultural level they live in, but that everyone can understand these deep mysteries. But you got to start somewhere, which is why he spoke to them in parables, things that they could understand. Now, I know a mustard seed is small, and I get the thing, but I think a radish seed is smaller. Now, I don't know about you who have ever planted a garden. I wasn't raised with it, but after I came into relationship with Almighty God, then I went and got a whole bunch, like a dump truck load of black dirt. And I didn't know it was a raised bed, but that's what I was doing. just naturally, and you put these seeds in the ground, and they just grow. Like you said, here, they just grow. And God provides the sunshine, and God provides the rain in a macro sense. I mean, you can put a sprinkler on it, but you learn about how fruitful the world is. Even a weed gives glory to God. Because, you know, we got burdock, we got these thistles and stuff like that that grow up all around me. I got to attack them. But, you know what an artichoke is? It's just a big thistle. But they're really good. So they provide fruitfulness. Even like a weed provides fruitfulness. Maybe in its, like, these purple weeds. You know, I mean, they kind of look good. We drive along the ditches and we see even weeds giving glory to God. And we learn the fruitfulness of God in that he's providing to us all the time. So then you see, in the first reading, where he's talking about planting this cedar. And they talk about the cedars of Lebanon, because like Jerusalem and all that is pretty dry, not a lot of vegetation. Now there's just buildings over everything. But what he's talking about is Mount Moriah. He's talking about the high point. And that Abram taking his son Isaac up there, and that, but there was establishment of this covenant. And that everybody lives under that covenant. Even we live under the covenant that God made with his people, Israel. So Trump was absolutely right in sending back the message that Jerusalem really is the capital, and that every other nation under God finds it in the shade of that great tree of Lebanon. But it's Jerusalem. That's why those people who are ungodly try and attack it. And isn't that what you see in politics? Well, don't look at me and all this corruption that I do, but I'm going to accuse somebody else of corruption, and then when they're exonerated, you don't even say you're sorry. You just start on another attack. So look for the fruitfulness. And if you don't see it, you know who they're aligned with. When you see fruitfulness, you see the relationship with God. Now, that doesn't mean everything we touch turns to gold like Midas. We're all going to experience suffering. We're all going to be persecuted for following Jesus Christ and him crucified. That's inevitable. He tells us that. But he also tells us to look at the fruitfulness that I give you. I mean, we live in one of the richest countries in the world. Not just economically, I mean. If we took every fallow field and every ditch between highways and put them in crops, we could feed the world, literally. We have so much here, we don't need to buy from any other country. And that fruitfulness that God has provided in the past, he will provide in the future. So we have to unbind our minds from the lies that have been perpetrated upon us and return to putting God first in our life, putting our family first, our marriage and our children. We need to put our friendships first. We need to be able to go and then say, I'm going to offer my skills and services. I'll get paid for it, but I'm doing it for the good of others, to create something new. Not take a handout, but rather put your hands on, and you will be part of that multiplicity, which is God's economy. If we come together of a like mind, led by the principles set forth by God the Father enumerated by Jesus the Son and empowered by the Holy Spirit, we will have the kind of world that God has always intended. So, be not afraid. Smile at people who couldn't see us smile. Tell people, God bless you. I always sneak it in at the end of a conversation on the phone. You know, when I'm ordering, I don't know, something from Amazon. I don't know if that's evil or not, but it just comes to my door. But I always say, God bless you. And I think we need to do that, really meaning, God bless you. Because I know he's blessing me. So I want to share that with you. God has not given us to destruction. You know, but we have to have faith. And then that faith projected in the future is our hope. So we have to hope in our future. Because it will be there. If we follow what God says to do. And then we will stand in the shade of that great cedar in Jerusalem. We will see our gardens grow and our children come to full stature, and life will continue until God decides that it's time for change. It's not now. There are changes. They are big, but they're temporary. And we can go and join together in the love of God and the love of each other and change back that which is selfish into something that is giving, loving, and for the good of all. May God continue to bless you and all your family members, your work, and your play. For God loves you, and he wants you to be happy.